From the web services introduction video, you know that many ServiceNow integrations require communicating with third-party systems, and that you can configure your instance to consume third-party web services through the outbound SOAP message and REST message modules. This video covers the SOAP message module. Click an item to go directly to that topic, or continue watching to cover all topics. Here, we're logged in with the web service admin role, which is required to access the system web services modules. The information needed to send SOAP requests is stored in SOAP message records. Let's take a look at one. Each record specifies the required format of the request in a WSDL. There are two ways to provide the WSDL. One is to select this checkbox to download the file. The other is to copy the entire WSDL XML text here and paste it into the records WSDL XML field here. If you choose to download the WSDL via URL, the URL must be accessible from the ServiceNow instance. It cannot be behind a firewall. This applies to any imports or includes of other WSDL definitions and XSDs in the parent WSDL. Also, ServiceNow does not support downloading WSDL through a mid-server. So if the instance cannot access the WSDL file, enter the WSDL content in the WSDL XML field instead of downloading it. ServiceNow supports basic authentication for WSDL retrieval. Selecting this checkbox displays fields for you to specify the user ID and password. After we have a WSDL file location or a complete WSDL document, we can use this Generate Sample SOAP Messages UI action to generate SOAP messages for each operation defined in the WSDL. Let's see how it works in this new SOAP message. We need to provide a name for the message. We'll just call it Demo Outbound SOAP. For convenience, we've stored the WSDL URL in this text file to copy and paste into the form. Now we could go to that URL and copy the WSDL text, and then clear the Download WSDL checkbox and paste the text into the WSDL XML field. But instead, let's unlock the WSDL field and paste the URL there. Locking it back up prevents accidental changes to the URL. Now we save it and generate sample SOAP messages. This populates the WSDL XML field with the text and produces SOAP message function records based on the WSDL. In these records, some fields are auto-populated from the WSDL. This is the SOAP function to invoke on the SOAP web service. The SOAP action header is available to be set if the SOAP web service requires it. The SOAP endpoint specifies the URL of the SOAP web service, and the envelope contains the payload to be sent to the web service. Now let's look at some of the other fields on this form. If a third-party SOAP web service requires web services security or mutual authentication, all the information can be configured here. For configuration steps, see the product documentation. If your SOAP web service can only be reached via a mid-server, you can configure your SOAP messages to be sent through a mid-server. To do this, specify the mid-server you'd like to send SOAP messages through. To use this functionality, there must be a running mid-server associated with your ServiceNow instance. Strip white space removes white space from the SOAP template before sending the request. Use basic authentication invokes authentication through username and password for the third-party web service. Selecting this checkbox displays the required fields. Mutual authentication allows a client and server to establish trust by exchanging and validating each other's SSL certificates. Mutual authentication is not available when making outbound web service calls through a mid-server. Selecting this checkbox displays the Protocol Profile field, where you can select a previously defined profile to use. Finally, the Envelope field defines the message to be sent to the third-party web service endpoint. The envelope data is set up with template parameters for variable substitution. Variable substitution allows you to take typically static content and make it dynamic by defining variables and mapping values to them through the scripting API. Here's the format for variable substitution, which can be used in the SOAP envelope field. Also note that if we needed to, we could edit the request in the SOAP function by manually modifying the XML text here. After the web service record is configured, we can use a test UI action to test it and resolve any issues. Let's see how to do that. Variable substitutions are defined in this related list for testing purposes only, but can be overridden through the scripting API. We add a definition to this list and give it a test value, in this case, a valid stock symbol. How about now for ServiceNow? When we test it, we see the result of running the test, including the request that was sent and the response that was received. Here, the symbol variable was substituted with the now stock symbol we specified earlier. The HTTP status code is reported here, 200, OK. And when we look at the response, we see that we did indeed get the data requested from the third-party web service. For stock symbol now, we have the last value and so forth. So this outbound web service message is working fine. Let's get back to that SOAP message function. Clicking this preview script usage link displays the script used to call that SOAP message. Note that you can use the setString parameter functions to override the values of variable substitutions at runtime. We can copy this script to use from any scripting level in the platform, that is, any place that can run a server-side script. Here are a few examples of where these scripts can be used: business rules, script includes, script actions, or even background scripts. The response body provides the response we saw when we tested this function, and this is how we get the HTTP status code to validate the request. Finally, the script uses the SOAP message V2 API. Check this article for available functionality. For more information, please consult our product documentation or knowledge base, or ask a question in the ServiceNow community.